Hello, everybody. Today we're going to discuss about the credibility theory. In 1910s in US, some of employers complained that the US workers' comp manual rating system is unfair. That is, they pay more attention to the workplace safety issues. As a result, compared to their competitors, in some years, the difference is more, and the other years, the difference is less. But consistently, their claims to claim premium ratio is less than their competitors. In other words, they pay too much premium compared to their claims. The Workers' Comp Rating Bureau listened to their complaints and confirmed the unfairness. Even though they were able to recognize the unfairness, they also knew that each employer's Workers' Comp related data is not enough to produce its own rate. In order to solve this issue, they call out help to statisticians nationwide. Statisticians came together and invented so-called credibility theory. And so also these statisticians is becoming the proper and casualty actuaries in US. This is a kind of starting point for that casualty actuary society. It was 1910s. So it's, the history is more than 100 years now. From beginning, two types of credibility concept showed up. One is called classical credibility, and the other is called modern or Bayesian credibilities, or Billman credibility, say. The reason for the latter name as modern or Bayesian is that the K value used in the formula is proven to be a expected value of process variance over variance of a hypothetical mean by Professor Billman in Germany. The classical credibility theory starts with a condition for the full credibility, where there is enough data to be decided its own rate. Assuming that each insured's claim occurrence process is based on Poisson distribution, which is very famous distribution function. Originally, it is assumed that binomial distribution, but there is a limitation of binomial distribution that is only fail or success. And by central limit theory, the total number of claims in a group will show normal distributions. This is more common and also has a nice bell type of shape of the graph. Poisson distribution is based on the probability that a number of events occurs during a given time, with a mean value equals to its variance, which is its unique characteristics of Poisson distributions, that mean value equals to its variance. So we need to estimate only one value, not other than two. So it's like a simpler way of estimating the parameters. For example, in an automobile insurance, a number of claims for certain insured during his policy period will show Poisson distribution with a certain parameter. A lot of them will show no claims. Some of them will show one claim. It will be pretty rare that two or more became so-called during its probably the policy period. We say that there are going to be like a probability of no claim, and one claim, probability of one claim, and then probability of two claims, and three claim, and etc. And total number of claims will show normal distribution with the mean value being equal to its variance by central limit theory. Still, even though it's a normal distribution functions, it maintains that the mean value is equal to its variance. And assuming the normal distribution, the issue is how many claims required in that group to guarantee the full credibility. Then we can assign a full credibility to such data and it can produce its own rate. We define such case as that plus minus k percentage of variation from the mean with the p of probabilities. For example, like plus minus 10% of variation from the mean with the 95% of probability. The following graph shows such case. So there's a limit minus k plus k percent plus n or plus k percent. And the probability of that area is percentages, which is like a guaranteeing that full credibilities. If it's the data has less credibility, then the graph is gonna be like a flatter, right? So doesn't satisfy this condition. Since the variance of the Poisson distribution is equal to its mean, given k and p, we can solve the equation to obtain the number of claims which meet the minimum, the full credibility condition. The logic is as number of claims increases, the credibility also increases. And eventually, there will be enough claims that the full credibility could be assigned. The following exhibit shows the number of claims for full credibility with K and P value. Here there's a P values and then there's those K values. For example, if P value is 95% and then the K value is 10%, then there's gonna be 384 claims. If you're assuming that P is 90% and K is 10%, that full credibility you can assign is gonna be 384. Of course that arbitrarily you assign P and K, but the logic is that every years, there are gonna be like a stable number of claims occur close to 484. Then you can say that the data is enough to assign full credibility and you can make its own weight based on that data. And also some other cases, if you assume like a P equal 95% and K equals 70.5%, then there are gonna be like a 683 claims you need to guarantee the full credibility. Okay, and then the classical, the credibility theory mostly applies to the liability lines where reasonable claims occur during a short period, like 1 year. Or it can be three, or if you use three-year data to make your own rate, then requires 3 years data. On the while, the formula for the partial credibility is defined as z equal root of small n over large n, where small n is the number of claims from experienced data. And then this large n is a capital N is the number of claims for the full credibility for that data. Then the new estimate with the credibility is calculated as follows. And there the LE is the estimate from the data, and LF is the value of assigned to the 1 minus G, and LF can be an estimate from the larger data to which the experienced data belongs, or more reliable estimates from other source. Then the estimate reflecting credibility is going to be LC. This is kind of a basic formula using classical theory, credibility theory, to estimate new rate or new estimates. Now we discuss about the modern credibility theory, or Buhlmann, or minimum scale, and etc. has many names. The modern credibility theory starts with the definition of further partial credibility, z equal n over n plus k. Well, n is the number of exposures, and k is initially a certain arbitrary value which reflects the characteristics of the data. For example, if the data shows high severity and low frequency and very unstable, the k value increases and the resulting z value would be decreases, because the data is like unstable, relatively unstable. You cannot assign large value of credibility. So then the k value is gonna become bigger. The while the data shows low severity and high frequency and relatively stable, the k value decreases, and the resulting z would increase. So here there's less fluctuations in your data. So you can set higher z values. So with the given small data, you can assign the larger z values. So their data is, because the data is more reliable. Here the drawback of this modern credibility theory is that the full credibility value has to be decided using some reasonable approach, because the formula does not produce the full credibility. It is well known and easily proved that the total variance is the sum of variance of the near hypothetical mean and the expected value for the process variance when the data shows independently identically distributed. This is a little statistics involved here. Say there are three, A, B, and C automobile insurance company with a market share of 50%, 30%, and 20%, with each loss ratio of 65%, 70%, and 75%, with 5 years of data. Then by ignoring each company designations, we can calculate a total variance and mean, where mean value is gonna be the hypothetical mean. We can calculate process variance and its mean for each automobile insurance company, multiplying each market share value to each process variance we obtain expected value of plus suspensions. Variance of the hypothetical mean is calculated using the process mean and hypothetical mean. In other words, the distance between these two is going to be the as you the value you're going to use. So distance scale, and then add each probabilities, you can get the variance for the hypothetical mean. Here we can calculate Toronto, for example, let me see. Okay, an American actually designed a famous example which explains the modern credibility theory using a simple diagram. He assumed that there are three hunters who are shooting at their own targets. Here we have three processes. The following the diagram shows the situations. We have hunter A shooting right above side, hunter B shooting left above side, and hunter C and below side. And then you can, based on this hunter A and B and C's shooting, you can obtain the hypothetical mean, which is kind of center of all those three hunters' mean values. Here you can calculate the hunter A, B, and C's variance and its mean values and the expected value for hunter's process variance by assigning that one of three probability to each hunter's, assuming that each hunter shooting the same amounts of shoots. Say hunter's shooting skill gets improved, then the shooting points get denser, and the expected value of process variance gets smaller. As a result, then the K value gets smaller, and the partial credibility G gets increased. And now say the distance between each hunter's mean value and hypothetical mean gets wider, then the variance of the hypothetical mean gets larger, and as a result, the K value gets smaller again, and the Z value gets larger. This relationship explains quite well the modern credibility theory. The property line and the workers' comp line use this modern credibility theory concept to calculate the partial credibility. In US, workers' comp experience credit debit calculation is fairly complex. Losses are separated as primary and excess loss. As a result, credibility is calculated from primary loss and excess loss separately. Okay, this is all about the introduction to credibility theory. Next time, we're going to discuss about reinsurance. Bye-bye.